Life Over Coffee, conversations for transformation.
Hello everyone, Rick Thomas here. You can find me at lifeovercoffee.com. Here's a question that I want you to roll around in your mind for a little bit. Did you know that you need more than preaching if you want to change? The Christian life is always evolving into Christ's likeness. We're growing up into biblical manhood or womanhood, but the ultimate goal is Christ's likeness. We call it progressive sanctification. Therefore, the question is, what is the process of change? Well, the question comes in play. Did you know that you need more than preaching if you want to change? One of the things that has happened in our culture, and it is a great thing, we make much of preaching, the preaching of the word. But if we are not careful, we can unwittingly blind ourselves, not realizing that the preaching of the word alone is not enough if you want to experience transformation. And that is the point that I hope to get across in such a way that it impacts us to think more about how the process of change happens so that we can continue to grow up into mature Christ-likeness. The preaching event on Sunday morning and the working out of the preached word during the week, these are not either-or activities. The preaching of the word and the working out of the word work together to help us Christians mature. See, the Christian life is not centered on the pulpit because the Christian lives his life chiefly everywhere else after the building door closes on Sunday. Think about the small amount of time that you are in that building, and then let's just reduce that time to the amount of time that you are hearing the preached word in that building. That is microscopic compared to how you live your normal day-to-day life everywhere else outside of the preaching of that word and outside of that church building. The person living by the preached word on Sunday alone, but not implementing context to work it into their soul, guess what? They will not mature, not the way that God intends, and not the way that the Bible teaches. There are 168 hours in our week, and the preaching event is less than, it's a one-hour soundbite out of each week. And even if we hear more than one sermon a week, it leaves us with over 165 hours to apply those sermons to our lives. Maybe your church, you have a sermon on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night. Okay, that's less than 3 hours. Maybe you just have a sermon on Sunday morning and you listen to your favorite preacher online a couple times a week. That's still less than 3 hours. And so we have 165 hours of living outside of the preached word. Life outside the church building makes our communities the practical epicenter of our Christianity. The epicenter is not the pulpit. The epicenter is not the preached word. The epicenter is where we spend our lives in community. Now, there are three spheres where we spend our lives primarily: within the Christian community, in the workplace for adults, and then also in our families. And for those who go to school, you spend a lot of time at school. But we spend a lot of time in every other place outside of the church building, specifically under the preached word. Therefore, the epicenter and the primary context in which we will experience transformation will be outside of the church building. Now, please understand, I do not have a low view of preaching. Preaching has a prominent place in our lives. I have a high view of preaching. I love the preached word. We need to preach it often. We need to preach it well. We need to exegete a passage of Scripture clearly. We need to craft our sermons properly, and we need to preach them with all the passion that God provides for us, because preaching is absolutely essential. But it's only supplemental. It has only a supplemental prominence when talking about the change process. You see, I'm talking about transformation, and you have to think about how does transformation happen. The New Testament does not make preaching the central focus of progressive sanctification. Actually, the gospel has that role in our lives. And to be more specific, Jesus Christ is the good news. Christ has a prominent and preeminent role in our lives, and preaching is one way to bring the gospel in view. You could say the epicenter of our Christianity is a cross. It's a tomb. It's a resurrected life. Preaching is an instrument to help us to see, to experience, and to understand the gospel, the centrality of Christ. Preaching is a significant tool, but it is one of many. Moses seemed to understand the balance between sound preaching and sound application. And that is what we have to understand ourselves. A high view of preaching, and again, I'm not downgrading preaching at all. I am keeping preaching elevated in my mind and heart, and I have never downgraded preaching. But what I am doing is I am elevating the application of preaching in our lives, because again, it's not an either-or situation. And Moses seemed to understand the balance between sound preaching and sound application when he taught the children of Israel how to parent. He gave them the Word of God, and then he gave them practical instructions on how to take the Word of God to their homes so they could apply it to their lives. You know this passage so well. It is Deuteronomy. Many of you have memorized this passage, actually. It's Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. You've heard it many times in your life, I would imagine. And I want to share this verse with you, and I want to divide it into that balance, the preaching of the Word and then the application of the Word, all right there in Deuteronomy chapter 6. Moses said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart." He is proclaiming who God is and the prominence of God on our hearts and the wonderfulness of God and how that should affect us. But then he is telling us how to live it out daily outside of the preached word. And so the rest of the verse gives us the practical application, and there's the balance. The preached word, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God." And now I want you to make sure that you practicalize that in your life. And so the rest of the verse says, "You shall teach them diligently," these words, "diligently to your children. And shall talk to them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and your gates." That is Deuteronomy chapter 6, 4 through 9. You know it well, and you see that balance there, a proclamation of who God is, and then how we want to contextualize that into our lives. This is absolutely essential. By the way, this is one of the things that I see so often in counseling. When, generally speaking, when people come to me with a personal problem, relationship struggle, situational difficulty, what you'll find all too often is that they are not contextualizing the Word of God in their lives. Most of the people that come to me and have over the past several decades, they attend a local church. They love their preacher. They love the preaching. But they are not being affected by the preaching. It's almost like they have a singular view of how transformation happens, being part of a local church and loving that preacher. And many times I'll ask them, "Why do you attend your church?" "Because of the preaching. Love the preaching." Now, that is fantastic in itself. But there has to be more than that. Okay, you love your preacher, you love the preaching, that's why you go to this particular church. How are you applying that wonderful preaching that that wonderful preacher preaches to you every Sunday? And what you will find over and over again, that they're not doing what Moses was asking the children to do with the preached Word of God. "Teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and your gates." Now, I'm not asking you that you imitate exactly what he said, legalistically and verbatim, but we have to approximate that in our New Testament lives, because if we are not working out what is being preached, then we will be counselees. And again, that's what I have found so often with the counselees that I've encountered over the years. Jesus' primary discipleship method took place in the context of people's lives where they were living. We say that Jesus was a great preacher, and he was. But when you go through the four Gospels, you will not find a lot of monologuing from Jesus. What you'll find is a lot of dialogue with Jesus as he interacted with people in the milieu in which they lived. And that's where you're going to find most transformation. You see, preaching is a passive event where we are listening to someone monologue and we are receiving it, but we have no way, as we're hearing the preached word, to apply it to our lives for the most part. We have to go out into our communities and then begin to interact with others, talk to others about what we have heard and engage them and ask them to engage us and create those reciprocal relationships so that we can mature. Jesus took his discipleship outdoors. And he used those contexts to draw out his disciples. And he was very good in these reciprocal relationships. I mean, he discipled them using the physical world. He was always illustrating the concrete physical world, like birds and flowers and camels and nard. And he was doing that to illustrate the spiritual world, like provision and sovereignty and anxiousness and worship and service and humility. There is a classic illustration of how he could take the physical concrete and move it to the spiritual abstract. And this is this beautiful passage of Scripture that you have heard in Matthew chapter 6, verses 24 to the end of the chapter, where he's talking about anxiousness. And you see the beauty of his preaching. This is a wonderful passage of Scripture. He says, "I tell you, do not be anxious about your life. What you will eat, what you will drink, know about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air." Here he goes. "And they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. And yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing?" Here he goes again. "Consider the lilies of the field," going from the concrete, physical, to make a spiritual application. "How they grow, they neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you a little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious. What shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? The Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them." And here's this beautiful verse that we've quoted often, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." This is a beautiful, beautiful preaching passage, and Jesus was a master teacher. But that is not how he spent most of his time. In fact, if you take out the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, there's very little monologue in the four Gospels because Jesus was an interactive dialoguer, because he worked that good word, like for example, what you just heard. He worked it into the psyche of his audience in these reciprocating relationships. Jesus was so in tune with his world and his audience that he never missed the opportunity to teach them God's practical and relevant ways. But primarily, he did this through interpersonal interaction with his community. If you were to do a study of the four Gospels and pull out all the words in red where Jesus is talking, what you will find is that the overwhelming majority of those scenes in those four Gospels is him dialoguing with someone. And we have to get that in our minds. We're not downgrading preaching at all. But what we are doing is elevating these dialogue reciprocating relationships where we are spurring one another on to loving good deeds and all the other one another's in the New Testament. I mean, sometimes he would teach them through a stand-up monologue, but typically when you'll see that in the four Gospels, he would come later and he would practically work out his teaching lesson through interaction in two-way dialogue. Let me illustrate that by giving you a passage of Scripture This is in Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. And so you take those 13 verses in Mark 4, and what you will see is what Moses did. Here's the proclamation of the word. Hear, O Israel, our God is one God. And then you will see, I want you to practically apply that. He appealed to them to apply it in their lives. And Jesus does this in practice. So if you take Mark 4, the 13 verses, I'm not going to read all of that to you. You can look at the passage yourself and divide it accordingly. But here's the public preaching. It starts this way. He began to teach by the sea, and a very large crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea, and the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. And he was teaching them many things in parables. And in his teaching, he said to them, listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And then he continues to talk through this parable about sowing. And then, let's divide the passage in Mark chapter 4. At the end, the bottom half, it says, And when he was alone, those around him with the 12, they asked him about the parables. And he said to them, to you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside, everything is parable, so that they may indeed see, but not perceive, and may indeed hear, but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven. And then he continues on for another verse. And so what Jesus is doing here in verses 1 through 9, Jesus was teaching a massive crowd from the pulpit, so to speak. And then in verses 10, 11, 12, and 13, he begins to unpack the teaching lesson in a personal, customized, relevant, practical way for his small group. And that is the balance. You can preach the Word of God to the masses on Sunday morning and praise God. Let that Word go forth with power. But you have to have a time set aside to where you can practicalize it in the hearts and minds of those who are serious and want to experience transformation. The pulpit is a great place to exalt the Savior, expound the gospel, and call people to live in holiness. And to be sure, God ordained preaching for the proclamation of the Word. It is critical. It is prominent in our lives. It is the foolishness of preaching that confounds the wise and empowers the faithful. But in addition to great preaching, you also find in Scripture that it is in the living rooms of our communities, where the truths preached from the pulpit works out in the context of our lives. You can encourage someone repeatedly from the pulpit to serve, and he may understand, personalize, and apply what you're saying. He may get it. Let's say we need to talk about feet washing. I'm not making a case here about feet washing, but I want to use that as an illustration. And you could preach the sermon where Jesus washed a disciple's feet. But if you bring a towel and a basin to the living room and you wash your friend's feet, you can be assured he will never forget that one act of other-centered serving. Let me give you a personal illustration. It was 1989 in Queens, New York. I was in an apartment of Hector and Alma Enriquez. They were our friends then and friends now. I was there with a bunch of preacher boys, and we were tracking the subways and working hard, sharing the gospel with the good folks in Queens, New York. And after a long week that we were all gathered in this small apartment to where almost our knees touched each other from across the room because it was tiny, we were exhausted. We were reclining on the couches and chairs. And then Hector Enriquez, a floor cleaner, first time I ever met him, I said, what do you do for a living? Because this is what men do, you know, what do? He said, I scrub floors for the glory of God. I never forgot that. He had a passion for Jesus, and he did everything with all his might. Well, Hector went into the other room, and he came out with a basin that was full of water and had a towel over his shoulder. And he came around to me where I was first, and he began to untie my shoes, and he took off my socks, and he put my feet in the water. And as he was washing my feet, he was praying, and he was crying. And I was humiliated. It was one of the most humbling acts that I've ever experienced in my life. And I've never forgotten it. It is as fresh today as it's seemingly as fresh today as it was when it first happened in 1989. That is the difference between hearing the preached word and practicalizing the preached word in the context in which you live. Now, again, I'm not making a case for foot washing, but I am making a case of the difference between theoretical preaching, no matter how good it is, but if we don't take that preached word and apply it practically in our lives, we are going to miss out on a lot of transformation that could happen in our lives. And so Jesus did not let the preached word stand alone. He modeled his message to drive home his points. Now, what I want to do now is to share with you a story about my friend Mabel. And I hope that this will help also to punctuate the point that I'm trying to make here, that there's a symmetry between the preaching of the word and the application of the word. And if we do not get both of these, then we are setting ourselves for a lot of transformation that won't happen. Now, this is part of a book that I've written, and it's in our store. It's called The Local Church. And what I would encourage you is to get that free downloadable book. It's a digital book. It's free. It's yours. You can have it. You can have 1 million copies, and you can share it with 1,000 of your closest friends. But in that book, I explain how we can contextualize the local church. I talk a lot on small groups and really applying and building those relationships. I'm not doing that here, but this is part of that book. And if you really want to explore the application of God's word, in addition to the profundity of the preaching of God's word, then I would encourage you to get that free book, Local Church, in our store. But first, Mabel. Mabel has heard wonderful preaching over the past 16 years of her life. Nearly every Sunday, she has been encouraged, enlightened, and envisioned how to be a woman of God. Recently, a growing bitterness took root in her soul toward her church, toward her pastor, and toward some of her friends. The more she hears the beautiful truths from the word declared from the pulpit, the more cynical and suspicious she becomes. She's seeing the discontinuity between the preached word on Sunday and her marriage and her family during the week. The dots are not practically connecting for her. And sadly, her cynicism and suspicion are directed toward God, though she would not say it that way. She hoped for a different life and believed it would come by going to church, as she put it. And I think that's actually part of the problem without being too wordsmithy on you. We use that language of going to church, which actually you cannot do in the most theological, technical sense because we are the church. What we do is we go to a building, and those buildings are red brick rectangular buildings, just like the Apostle Paul with white steeples on top. Sometimes those church buildings are on Main Street. Sometimes they are dance studios, which we planted a church one time in a dance studio. We also had church meetings in a Seventh-day Adventist building, which was really cool because it had all the amenities and they were not meeting there on Sunday. We met in a hotel for a while. The church met in a hotel. We don't say that we're going to church, and we don't say we're going to hotel. No, the church gathers in all of these different places. In Queens, New York, it was the American Legion Hall, where we met. We'd come in early on Sunday morning and clean up the beer cans and where people were throwing up on Saturday night and so forth. It smelled of alcohol and throw up, and we had our church meeting there. But she would talk about going to church, and again, without being too word policey, that is part of the problem. We go to a building, and that is only a part of what the church does. We gather where two or three people are gathered, and we do church because we are the church. Her belief regarding the church is why she committed herself to God and the meetings of the church. She even took a ministry in the church to help in whatever way that she could. Her faith, her practice were genuine. Mabel loves God. That point needs to be understood. But like a person asleep in a boat, only to awake hours later to find that they've drifted beyond the buoys, Mabel's marriage has seemingly slipped past the point of no return. All the while, she is faithfully committed to her local church. Do you see a discontinuity there? my life and my marriage is just swirling around the drain, and I'm faithfully committed to my local church. Mabel is not struggling with sound doctrine. She doesn't have a theological problem regarding her understanding of the Bible. What she has is a methodological problem. Building a knowledge base, learning and growing in theological understanding is half the equation. Mabel is getting good information on Sunday morning. It is consistently biblical, easy to understand, and it is well delivered. Her problem and need is the other half of the solution. Her church has not provided or trained her to take the good word preached and work it out in the milieu, the environment, the context of her life. She needs a way to ensure clear and practical application. The Lord did not design the Sunday church meeting to fulfill that part of what she must have. You could say that Mabel is half full. She knows the word, but she does not have the equipping to apply it practically in ways that matter to her life, to her marriage, and other relationships. If she continues this way, she'll run on empty before long. I'm going to go back to the question that I began with. Did you know that you need more than preaching? If you want to change, I trust that I've made my case, but I also want to share these questions with you too. They will serve a person like Mabel. They will serve us as we think through biblical solutions regarding comprehensive discipleship in the context of a local church community. As you reflect on what I just shared with you, consider using these questions. I have 9 question sets that I'm going to ask you. It's a template for our thoughts. I would appeal to you to ask these questions about your church with all humility and charity. Maybe discuss these questions with at least one confident, confidant, competent friend so that you can have this fruitful discussion. I've designed them to bring clarity to your life and your church community. They will challenge you to think through your motives for being part of your local church and your reasons for attending each week. Here are the questions. Is your church practically walking out a relational model of gospel-centered living versus a functional model that keeps you busy but doesn't build relationally? You see, Mabel had a functional model of ministry in her church. She was busy doing work, but it was not a relationally centered model. And there's a difference between being relationally centered and ministry centered. And some people will choose being ministry centered because you can hide in ministry like you can hide in a Bible study. But if it is relationally centered, then there will be challenges. There will be that reciprocality. Number 2, as you move from the pulpit to the periphery of the church, do all the lives of the church people model gospel-centered living? Now, let me caveat that. When I say all the lives, it would probably be better to say those who are committed to the church, because on Sunday morning, there's a transient culture. There are people who have just been there for a minute. There are new converts. They are still on the milk of the Word, and so they haven't hit that growth area where they know how to apply the Word of God to their lives. But for those who are committed to the Word, they have been there for more than a minute, as you move from the pulpit to the periphery, are they being transformed by the gospel as it's being practicalized in their lives? Are they being transformed in measurable and objective ways? Number 3, is there an intentional plan implemented for disciple making? Is it producing and reproducing disciple makers? I mean, the key to discipleship, the litmus test to discipleship is the replication. If we are not fulfilling the Great Commission by replicating disciples, growing them up so they can go out and make disciples, then the Christian mission will seek to exist. We're one generation from it going away. Therefore, we need to be growing people up and maturing them so they can do the same. Number 4, is there intentional biblical care and accountability taking place in individual lives? The operative word here is intentionality. Are we being intentionally intrusive in each other's lives for care and accountability? Number 5, are the men of the church leading their families? How do you know? The men of the church, the husbands of the church, the fathers of the church should be leading their families. And again, with all humility and charity, what is the majority report of the committed men of the church? Those who have been there for more than a minute, what is the majority report? Are they directionally heading toward Christ-likeness and their wives and their family, their children are following them? Number six, is the faith of the church families exportable? We have an exportable gospel, as I was saying earlier about disciple making. And so within the family construct, it is the husband and the wife, they're exporting the gospel to the next generation, which is their children. So one of the ways that you can assess this is by talking to the church's teens. If the parents are being discipled well and they are responding to that discipleship, it will manifest in many, not all, of the parents of the children of the parents. Now, I'm not talking about, are these children born again? I am not even talking about, do they have a passion for Christ? Being born again and having a passion for Christ, we can't shoehorn that into our children's lives. I think many of us wish we could. That is grace given. However, if the parents have a direction of walking toward God and they are being transformed regularly into Christ's likeness, that will have an effect on them. It's like a hand and a glove. The hand may not be in the glove, but the hand looks like the glove, and maybe someday the hand will be regenerated and it will slide right into that glove. And there won't be a whole lot of change there because, again, they have been impacted by parents who are pursuing Christ, even though they may be rebels at this point rejecting God, but there will be a positive effect in these children's lives. Number seven, do you experience biblical fellowship with a few fellow members? Now, biblical fellowship is sharing personally and intimately and practically what God is doing in your life. Do you have at least one friend to where you can have that kind of relationship? Number eight, suppose you have a relational problem or situational difficulty. Are you comfortable? Are you confident that you can go to your church leadership to describe your problem and receive competent care to walk you through it? Or do you seek solutions outside the local church because your church is not able at this time to be able to help you? It's a fair question that we have to ask. We must ask, and we can do that with humility, but we don't want to blind ourselves to what is right in front of us, and we don't want to complain about it either. We don't want to be that grumbling Christian. If your church is not able to help people, then you are a part of that church. And, well, that means, well, maybe you're unable to help people as well. And so you want to jump in and make a difference in this area of the application of the preached word. And then finally, number nine, why are you part of a local church? Is it because of the preaching? Like, primarily? I hope not. I hope you are a part of that local church for another. Are you transforming? Are your friends and family members experiencing transformation in proportion to their engagement with the local church? If you want to read this particular chapter from my book, Local Church, which you can find in our store at lifeovercoffee.com, this one's titled, You Need More Than Preaching If You Want to Change. And so I would love for you to, you can print off this article here, or you can take the digital book, you can print it off if you wish. You can pass it out, have everyone in your small group to get this digital book about the local church and spend a season going through it. I promise you that if you are dead serious on making change and you find 2, 3, 5, 10 other people that are dead serious on making change. I have CTAs, I've just read 9 of them to you at the end of each chapter. And so all of our resources that we build, it's a workbook. And this is a workbook. And so you can go through each chapter and then respond to the CTAs at the end. I think God will meet you there and do some wonderful things in your life. Thanks so much, and God bless.
Thanks for joining us. Learn more and get access to other resources at lifeovercoffee.com.